Yusri here. This video is for the course Mass Transfer and Separation Processes, and I am from the Environmental Technology Division of the School of Industrial Technology, University Science, Malaysia. The learning outcomes of this topic are, number one, you'll be able to describe the solubility of gases and liquids and its connection to absorption. Number two, you'll be able to describe the different type of plate and packed absorption columns and the contact phenomenon between gas and liquid. Number three is that you'll be able to explain the flooding phenomenon and its relationship to gas and liquid flow rates and pressure drop. And finally, number four, you'll be able to describe the mass balance principles of an absorption column and mass transfer coefficients. Topics in gas absorption include number one, equilibrium solubility of gases and liquids. Number two will be plate or tray column. Number three is packings and packed column, and there's going to be one example for that. Number four is general design requirements of an absorption column. And finally, number five, the principles of absorption. Inside a gas absorption column, mass transfer process occurs, and it is an interface process. And this process is dependent on diffusion rates between the two phases. Diffusion is defined as the movement of substance from a higher concentration phase to lower concentration phase. The components of a gas will be transferred to a liquid, which is also known as a sorbent. Some of the common application of gas absorption is to remove carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide gases from natural gas by absorption. And the sorbent used in this application is amines or alkaline salts. So one example is the MDEA or the methyl diethanol amine. And this sorbent absorbs gas through chemical absorption. There are also alkaline salts, and two popular alkaline salts are aqueous potassium carbonate or sodium carbonate, and these alkaline or these sorbents absorb gas through physical absorption. This is an example of an alkaline salt sorbent, the potassium carbonate solvent. It absorbs gas through physical absorption. This is a slide on the equilibrium solubility of gases and liquids, which is a very important parameter in the absorption process. The degree of absorption of a gaseous component in a sorbent or solvent depends on the phase equilibrium between the gas and the sorbent or solvent. When a gas and liquid are in contact and are allowed to remain in contact for a long time, which means when it reaches equilibrium, some of the gas would get absorbed into the liquid. The concentration of gas in the liquid is called gas solubility, or how much of the gas can get absorbed by the liquid. Now, gas solubility depends on temperature and pressure. So in general, solubility would increase if the temperature of the solvent is low. On the other hand, if the temperature of the solvent is high, gas solubility would decrease. Gas solubility would have an inverse relationship with pressure, where at high pressure, gas solubility would increase, but at low pressure, gas solubility would decrease. A common solvent of carbon dioxide is MDEA, or methyl diethanolamine. But even though this is a good popular solvent used to absorb carbon dioxide, it still takes a long time for this solvent to reach equilibrium with carbon dioxide, about 3 to 4 hours. These are figures taken from the article Solubility of Carbon Dioxide in Aqueous MDEA Solutions from the Journal of Chemical Engineering Data. It shows four panels with three plots in each panel. The one with the circled marker is at temperature of 323.15 Kelvin. The one with the square marker is at a temperature of 348.15 Kelvin. And the one with the triangle marker is at 373.15 Kelvin. So this shows the effect of temperature on solvent's capability to dissolve carbon dioxide. The difference between the four panels is the amount of MDEA, or the concentration of MDEA by mass percent. So this panel here is 5 mass percent of MDEA solution. Figure 4 here is 20.5 mass percent of MDEA. Figure 5 is 50 mass percent, and figure 6 is 75 mass percent. So these four panels shows the changes in the concentration of MDEA used. So let's try to understand each panel. So the x-axis is the loading ratio, or how many moles of carbon dioxide can get absorbed for 1 mole of MDEA. So at this point here is 0.2 moles of carbon dioxide can get absorbed by 1 mole of MDEA for 5 mass percent of MDEA. So at 0.2 mole of CO2 would have a carbon dioxide partial pressure of 2 kPa. Without looking at it in too detail, we can see that as temperature increases, the loading ratio would decrease at a higher partial pressure. This goes to show that at higher temperature, the solvent has less capability in absorbing carbon dioxide at any partial pressure. So as we increase the amount of MDEA used, we see that at higher concentrations of MDEA, we see that the amount of carbon dioxide that can be absorbed becomes higher. This slide shows the solubilities of gases in water, which is also a very common solvent use because of its availability as well as its cost. Here we see three different panels for three different gases. The trend of the solubility of these gases in water is similar, but if you look closely at the y-axis, you see that the amount that can get absorbed is different. So here is a range from 0 to 1000, while here is a range from 0 to 4, and here is from 0 to 0.08. At higher temperature, the solubility of ammonia becomes less, but notice that the amount of ammonia that can be absorbed is high compared to, let's say, carbon dioxide, where there is about a 100 times difference between ammonia and carbon dioxide. And compare this with oxygen. The amount of oxygen that can be absorbed by water is at a 100 times lower than the amount of carbon dioxide that can be absorbed by water. So what does a schematic of an absorption column look like? This is a schematic of an absorption tower or column. Liquid solvent coming down from the top of the tower and flows down the column. And we have the gaseous mixture, another flow from the bottom of the column and moves up towards the top of the column. So as the liquid solvent and the gaseous mixture come into contact within the column, some of the gas will get absorbed into the liquid solvent, while some of them will not be absorbed, moves out of the column at the top. The solvent laden with the absorbed gas exits at the bottom of the column. This is a chemical absorption process schematic flow diagram taken from the Journal of Petroleum Science and Engineering from this paper titled "The Removal of Carbon Dioxide and Nitrogen Gas from Natural Gas." This is figure 2 from that article. Basically, there are two flows through this process. One is the gas flow, comes in from here and up to here, and another is the solvent flow, which is from here, go through all of this, and gets recycled back into the absorption column. So first, the sour feed gas. This is a common term used for unprocessed gas. The sour feed gas goes into an inlet separator, and this inlet separator would separate the gas into two components. One component that consists of water, C2 hydrocarbons, and the other is a gas that has less water and C2 hydrocarbons. At 33 degrees Celsius, which enters this absorption column, which is also called the amine contactor, comes into contact with the solvent, in this case it's an amine, and leaves the column to the top. And this process gas is called sweet gas, which goes into another plant or another process. 80% of this process consists of units that deals with regenerating the solvent that comes into contact with the sour feed gas, because the solvent would absorb the undesirable gases, in this case carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas, from the natural gas, and it needs to be regenerated in this process before it can be reused in the absorption column. So if we follow through the units that's involved, or through the processes that's involved to regenerate the lean amine, we see that it will come down to the bottom, and this amine would consist of carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas, which goes into this flash tank, and this flash tank's job is to vaporize some of the carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas from the solvent so that it gets removed here as a fluid called flash gas. And some of the amine that has less of the carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas would flow through the bottom of this flash tank and comes up into this heat exchanger before it goes into another column called the stripper or regenerator. It goes through this heat exchanger because it needs to be fed into the stripper regenerator at a higher temperature range, in this case 93 degrees Celsius. So it exchanges heat with another flow that comes from the bottom of the column, which is at a higher temperature of 105 to 125 degrees Celsius, and it gets heated to 90 plus degrees Celsius, and it goes inside here at a higher temperature. It has to be at a high temperature so that it has more chance in vaporizing or in releasing the carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas from the solvent. Now, as it goes down, it will be cooled and flows inside this reboiler. This reboiler's job is to reheat it to be reintroduced back into the stripper regenerator. It reheats the amine using steam. So this is a separate system. It doesn't come into contact directly, but it exchanges heat with the solvent in this reboiler unit. And a part of the amine that goes through this stripper regenerator would have less of carbon dioxide, flows out here, and goes through this heat exchanger to transfer some of its heat to the amine that hasn't gone through this stripper regenerator. And this would have less of carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas compared to before, compared to this, and goes through this another filter, go through a pump just to increase the pressure of the flow before being cooled to 40 degrees Celsius. Notice that it's a lot cooler here so that it has more chance of absorbing the carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas as it comes into contact with the gas that flows through up this column. The gas that gets removed from the solvent would flow up, goes inside a reflux or inside a cooler. Notice the temperature is at 37 to 43 degrees Celsius. It gets separated into two phases. One is gas, another is liquid because it's cooled. And some of the liquid here would be, which is amine, will be added back into the process to increase the efficiency of this stripper regenerator, while the CO2 and nitrogen gas, which is at a higher concentration, will be released outside of this process. Now, this is a physical absorption process schematic flow diagram. So the sour feed enters the absorption column, comes into contact with the solvent, and move out as process gas or the sweet gas that goes into another process or another plant. And the lean solvent comes down, comes into contact with the gas, and absorbs the carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas from the sour gas, and comes down out the bottom of the absorption column with carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas in it. It goes into this high pressure flash system or unit solvent that is in liquid form that moves from the bottom of this flash unit and goes into another flash unit, removes carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas from the solvent out of the process through this flow named acid gas. The solvent that has less of this carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas would flow out of this, out the bottom of the flash tank, and into another flash unit, or called here the low pressure flash, to remove again those gases. So there are three stages of removal of the carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas from the solvent before it gets pumped back into the absorption column. Before it comes into the absorption column, it goes through this chiller to reduce the temperature of the solvent so that it has a higher solubility of carbon dioxide and nitrogen gas from the sour feed gas. That's the end of this topic, and I'll see you in the next video.